good.
Okay, thank you all, Annie, for introduction. Okay, so I have nothing to discuss. Okay, so we want to talk about the CPAP. So when you say the baby on CPAP, that means the baby on CPAP, but 100% breathe spontaneously. You patient on respirator, then you call PEEP, okay? If a patient on respirator and he has IMV rate and all such thing, you call PEEP. You call CPAP, you tell me CPAP. So I know he's on patients on CPAP. And we use this CPAP since 1973. So now it's almost 30,000 baby has been treated with the CPAP. This is not just for the RES premature baby. There's a lot of congenital heart disease, or PQ, and also patient after extubation, usually we use the CPAP. Okay, so the CPAP effect, from number 1 to 7, you probably can see anywhere. Okay, like increased pulmonary pressure, so increase the FRC, you prevent alveoli collapse, so you will decrease the intrapulmonary shunt, and also you preserve, conserve the surfactant if you prevent the alveoli collapse. Okay, prevent pharyngeal wall collapse. That's why even adults, when they have a sleep apnea, they use a sleep with CPAP. They stabilize chest wall, increase airway diameter and spring the airway or spring the diaphragm. Okay, you can see this anywhere. But not too many people is thinking about this CPAP stimulate the growth of premature lung. And also use a bubble CPAP for high frequency ventilation effect. So this in the animal study is a fat baby. So they this heart on CPAP and this no CPAP group. 2 weeks later, they sacrifice this animal. And you see the CPAP group, their lung volume are higher, are heavier, and just not because of pulmonary edema, because the protein and DNA are all higher. So this lung growth is real, okay? So CPAP stimulate lung growth. So people, when they're talking about premature baby, they all think about surfactant deficiency, the RES. this is a very pointer. Okay, people all thinking about the so it's just different from my computer. Okay, so people are talking about the RES premature baby, but RES actually is the first one day, two days problem. So why is this premature baby after that they still have problem breathing? Because their lung are immature, okay? So since CPAP stimulate growth of immature lung, so at Columbia, CPAP is not just for the RES, because the CPAP stimulate the growth of the immature lung, so we keep the premature baby on CPAP. Even they are already on Lumeo CPAP, but when you take it off, there's still problem breathing, okay? So that means their lung need to grow more. So as long as the patient has tachypnea retraction or apnea bradycardia, we put the CPAP back until he on Lumeo CPAP, he looks so comfortable, and you say, oh, maybe he's ready, you try off, and if you're no more symptomatic, doesn't require oxygen, he's cured. If he had again, then we put a CPAP back in near grow more. I think that Colombia's BPD incidence always less than 10%, even before surfactant are invented. And one of the reasons, because the baby is born, we put on CPAP right away, So the alveoli don't collapse, so they breathe, produce their own surfactant. The number two reason, because when the patient RES, we keep the CPAP as long as they need it. So most of the CPAP study you read, you know, the CPAP group and other group, and 1 week later, they out of the CPAP. No wonder the CPAP group never decrease the BPD incident, and that's the reason. So this is very important, okay? The premature baby this year had symptomatic, not because RES, RES only first 1 day, 2 days problem. After that, because their lung immature, they need to grow more. So CPAP stimulate lung growth, so keep them on CPAP, you will recover faster, okay? Use a bubble CPAP, so the people measure this airway pressures. And see this waveform, this high frequency amplitude, this frequency, the divisionality like the oscillator, on high frequency oscillator, okay? So this is in a rabbit study. This is designed by the engineer. So this that's what we do when we immerse in the liquid, in the water, okay? And when you see the bubble, so you do see this bubble recalls this high frequency ventilation effect. When you make an angle like that, you have more. When you angle like 135 degrees, you see you will have a volume 3.3 cc and 3.9 hertz or high frequency. So use a bubble CPAP, you have a high frequency ventilation effect. And also in the group on this, the vocal breathing are lower than the others, okay? So this study, this is designed by an engineer from Seattle, and they, so they don't have a patient, so this in the rabbit. So I'm sure in the very near future, you will see a lot more with this type of bubble CPAP. Okay, I don't know, just so go. Okay. Well, just let them play in this computer. So actually, I show the with this bubble, and this bubble is bigger. Okay. Okay, so now let's do a CPAP indication. When you, what you can do with a CPAP. So CPAP increase FRC, so any disease like RES or transient tachypnea, or the patient had a PDA or their pulmonary edema, the CPAP will help this. Let's look at how the CPAP helps the RES, okay? You know, you sit in here, you breathe in, when you see the Laplace law, there's a tendency retraction to make a volume smallest. That's pressure is proportion to this surface tension and inverse proportion to the radius. So when you sit in here, your inspiration, your expiration radius decrease. Why you alveoli don't collapse? Because you have the surfactant to decrease the surface tension. So premature baby, if you have a surfactant deficiency, okay, so when they exhale, the radius decrease, they will retraction, and that's why they will collapse, okay? So we can help the baby with the CPAP to increase the radius, okay? So you put them on CPAP, you have to try to put it early, you know, before the baby, when the baby is born, the lung full of fluid. So before all the fluid absorbed, then you have a liquid, air liquid interface, then the Laplace law apply. So you want to make sure you put a CPAP on before this fluid all absorbs. So it's very important. When the baby born under distress, you put a CPAP right away. So they don't collapse, and then they will breathe. And when they breathe themselves, and they will produce their own surfactant. Okay? So a lot of premature baby, when they're born, they have surfactant deficiency. But if you put on CPAP, prevent the alveoli collapse, when they breathe, they produce their own surfactant, then they don't need exogenous surfactants. That's why, okay? But you know, it should be kept early, not wait until they will collapse, then CPAP won't be enough. So CPAP also good for apnea, bradycardia. The long term what the people measure, just one now the problem, they have a low FRC. Okay, CPAP also very good for meconium aspiration. So this is meconium, typical X-ray of meconium aspiration syndrome. And you probably, I'm sure you will ask, oh, this lung is so hyperinflated. This X-ray only taken when the baby was 15 minutes old. And this lung already so hyperinflated. Why you want to put CPAP pressures? See, almost everybody, most people ask me why to do that. Now, let's see why. This baby, in 15 minutes, his lung becomes so hyperinflated. Okay, so you have a, say you have meconium plaque there, okay? So during inspiration, our airway is bigger, so the air can get in. When we expiration, airway becomes smaller, so you may cannot exhale. So that's why you have a bulbar effect, that's why the lung becomes so hyperinflated so quickly, okay? So without CPAP, he had problem exhale. So you put a CPAP, increase airway diameter, so they can exhale. That's why it is very helpful. Again, you have to put a early, not wait until they develop complication like a pneumothorax like that, then it will be too late, okay? There's another reason, for instance, you have a meconium plaque here. So the airway become narrow, so when the patient cannot complete exhale, so you have inadvertent PEEP plus six here. So if you don't put a CPAP here, the next inspiration, you have to generate more than minus six to get air in. You put a CPAP, say, on 5 here, you just need a minus 1 to get air in, and that's called waterfall effect. So that's the reason why CPAP is very good for meconium aspiration syndrome. Okay, just no baby die from meconium aspiration syndrome because of meconium aspiration syndrome. No baby die from since 1980. Okay, and the reason, I think, that because when the obstetrician tells he delivered, he had meconium, we look at the baby. If he's breathes comfortably, not symptomatic, we leave the baby alone. If he had required oxygen, he's distressed, we put a CPAP right away. And 15 minutes later, you will see the different baby. Of course, he's big, usually post-mature. So when you put a CPAP, of course, he will fight. Okay, how you know the baby doesn't know, it's just going to help him. So of course, initially, you put a CPAP, you will fight, okay? So you need somebody to help hold the head and put a CPAP on, and after when they start breathing, they become more comfortable, they quiet down, okay? They don't need sedation, okay? So this another, most of the people didn't miss this. CPAP is very good for meconium aspiration syndrome. So CPAP also good for airway closure disease such as bronchiolitis, or the patient has BPD, or the patient has trichomalacia or partial paralysis of diaphragm, such as patient sometimes after PD ligation, the diaphragm paralyzed for 6 weeks. You know, those kind of patients, you don't have to intubate, you just need to put on CPAP. Or sometimes hyperalimentation, you know, dig into the pleural cavity and the patient had a paralyzed or one side or that, you just use a CPAP. And they will recover, maybe take 6 weeks. You don't need to placate them, you don't need intubation. And also, we extubate a patient when the patient respirator, we extubate almost always to the CPAP and then we inform the CPAP. Okay, now let's look at the CPAP device. Actually, it's very simple. Like you have a T-tube, and you have one side provide a gas source. So all the air, liquid, air difficult to escape. So you have positive pressure and connect just to the patient's airway. Okay, so in the United States, we all have the oxygen blender. So it's very easy. We can adjust the FiO2. Okay, and fluorometer, and just remember, just connect to have to be more than 35 psi. But in here, all the come from the wall, the central supply that come out is 50 psi, so there's no problem with that. Okay, so 50 psi is more, is like more than 3,000 centimeter water pressures. So when you connect just to that, when you turn on, it's hard to stop. Okay, so the gas will come, so you put some resistance or something, so you will see your positive pressures, okay? So if you had a chance to go to the developing country, you don't have an oxygen blender, you can just use an air hurometer and an oxygen, and use this, for instance, you want 50% oxygen, and you want a total flow of 7 liters, you draw the line, 4.2 liter air, with a 2.8 liter oxygen, and we give you approximately 50%, okay? You want 75%, you draw a line between 70 and 80, okay? So if you run out the oxygen blender, I don't think no excuse cannot use a CPAP. So all the hospital I visit, they all have oxygen. But some people say, oh, we don't have a compressed air. But there's people drive the car. So there's a compressed air in your country. Okay, so if you want it, you can get it. Okay, so now to create the whole difficult air to escape, one is immersion in the dig in the water. Okay, you remember if you just this tube immerse 5 cm depth, this point pressure will be 5 centimeter water pressure. If you just run the mercury, then it will be 5 millimeter mercury, right? Send a mercury, okay? So you turn this on, so this will come up, okay? You cannot stop with this. So the pressure more than 5, if this is a 5 cm, so you will bubble, okay? You have a higher flow, bubble more. Less flow, less bubble. Pressure is independent to the flow. Okay? It's only depends what the emerge, depth of the immersion. Okay, other way you can use, people use a respirator. So you connect, use a respirator exhalation valve to adjust the resistance. So flow times the resistance will be the pressures. Okay, so this is flow dependent. So for instance, you have a Meconium aspiration syndrome, you use the post mature, the strong. Okay, so you use this bubble CPAP. Sometimes when you cry, you see more bubble. Pressure about the same. When you use a respirator, you didn't change the resistance. So flow increase, you will see pressure go high like that. Okay, so I don't think this is safe for the especially the baby, big baby like a Meconium aspiration syndrome. Okay. So this compare with the bubble CPAP with the respirator CPAP. See that there's no different from CO2 and oxygenation. But when the infant, so when they are on bubble CPAP, they decrease the minute ventilation by 39%. And decrease the respiration rate by 7%. And this thing is because this bubble CPAP has a high frequency ventilation effect. Just again, premature lamp, so on bubble CPAP, you have a lower PaCO2, higher PaO2, pH and FRC, and less ventilation perfusion mismatch. And also have low alveoli protein when you use a bubble CPAP in animal. And just in the infant, when the patient, infant on bubble CPAP, they have a higher, they have a better oxygenations. Okay? Now the third part, you connect, you design this CPAP device, now you're going to connect to the patient's airway. Okay? So baby is obligatory nasal breather. So you can put the cover the whole head with head hood, airtight, okay? So you have positive pressure, use a whistle seal, you have a face mask, okay? Or nasal mask. So this, when I started, 1973, the people use a face mask. So the mask is rubber, make of rubber. So you have to tight, and they find out, so when they exhale, to the mask, so they inhale again. So they say that, oh, the mask CPAP CO2 is higher. So they, and they will find out because you have to have airtight, they have a cerebellum hemorrhage, okay? And you, that time the mask is not as good, so you have to, every hour on the hour, you take it out and massage the waist, otherwise you may have a necrosis, okay? And they, this got all harder to do it. So now most of people use a Hassan plan, okay? So we'll see, we'll show you that later. All people use a nasal cannula, or nasal pharyngeal tube, or endotracheal tube, okay? Not all CPAP devices are created equal, but most of the CPAP studies, they even didn't tell you what kind of device they are using, okay? So this 1914, this professor from Netherlands, he published in his book, he already showed this use a mask CPAP, but this in an adult. Okay, and this was, this mask was, this guy, see, in 1911, showed this mask CPAP, okay? So, I don't know what happened, so, and I don't know what happened, why with the CPAP, why people don't mention, they don't use us anymore until Gregory showed in the baby, so, use a CPAP, so before the CPAP and after the CPAP, so the CPAP helped. So Gregory, that's the time they are using an endotracheal tube, okay? So endotracheal tube and this gas supply and this screw clamp make a difficult to escape, so you had a positive pressure, you made the pressure. And he put this there, this is not a bubble CPAP. This is a 30 centimeter in case the baby near back. So you can squeeze this back and you can generate pressure up to 30 centimeter water pressures, okay? I think he's a report, two patients was on head box. So in the head box, there's a lot of noise there. You have to resuscitate, you know, you have to get this out, harder to get it out, okay? Also, when I started, I saw people use this, the hospital use CPAP. Doesn't look nice, but work. You know, this work, okay? This baby's head is inside. You have positive pressure, you got a CPAP, okay? Like that, okay? All people use a mask. This is a different mask in this paper, but that time in the United States, you all put a strap, you know, around, and that's why they cause cerebellum hemorrhage. And also, I see this kind of argyle, like that. So you put this on the baby. So that's, of course, the baby is bigger, okay? So usually you put it like this, you have the sandbag, head doesn't move, this on the roof of the incubator, so this doesn't move, so we stay. But when the baby move, this thing is out. So that's time, so when I saw Gregory say, CPAP is working, but last time a neonatologist says, no, the CPAP doesn't work. And I found out the reason doesn't work because it doesn't stay, okay? So when the baby moves, this is out, baby don't get the oxygen, baby don't get the CPAP. That, of course, doesn't work. So I saw the problem because I saw I modified to this way, okay? So modified use a nasal cannula and I fixed this to tubing on the baby's head. So when the baby head moves, this stay. And that's why we succeeded since 1973. Okay, so last time we see the baby, before we use the CPAP, they come in, you put on head box, you know, maybe 30% in the afternoon, 50% and we intubate respirator, cannot use the IMV, so you have to sedate the patient, and then the next day you see the PI in the afternoon, you are put in a chest tube, okay? So I said, no, I'm not going to spend my career doing this thing. Then I start to read this CPAP, so I find out, so I modify to this, and since we put on baby on CPAP, instead it deteriorated, they improve. So all of a sudden, the pneumothorax is gone, the respirator is gone, okay? All right, so there's also other facial, okay? So this, like this, very similar, like argyle, okay? But this is very lightweight, and this, they can stay, okay? But the problem is you have to be, later I will say, this plant should never touch the septum. You touch the septum, you don't know how much pressure. Too much pressure, you're going to have a septum erosion, okay? But this type, you have to be sealed. So cannot go away, stay away from the septum. And infant flow, so this supposed during inspiration, air toward the baby, expiration away, so decrease work of breathing, okay? But they compare, but the problem, same as that one, you cannot stay away from the septum. So, but the people compare with the Fisher Paykel and this one, the Fisher Paykel is better, okay, in the baby. All right, but these two things, the main reason is, you know, I cannot keep this away from my septum, okay? So you cannot use this for the 400 gram baby like we do, otherwise you're going to have a septum problem. And most of the CPAP studies show, use the CPAP, nasal prong CPAP, you have a 30% of septum injury, and that's because you couldn't stay away from the septum. That's why, okay? All right, so we use this kind of nasal prong, okay? So this look very similar, right? But take a look more carefully. This thing is a curve, this is straight. So I call this a cannula and this a prong. So when you put a cannula on the upper lip, the prong, the, you know, the nasal cavity is that way. So the prong curve will face through a nasal cavity. Straight go that way, okay? So it's different. Even looks very similar, but it's different, all right? So when, this in the early 1980, we asked Mr. Hudson to make a CPAP plan for us. Before that, usually we use adult nasal cannula, and they're too far apart the plan. We cut the piece and grow together. And used that for several years until we asked Mr. Hudson to make it for us. Mr. Hudson said, Dr. Wang, if you think this help the baby, I will help you. So he sent a manager to Colombia to see how we use a CPAP and said, oh, we can do that. So they sent me to their company, see how they make a plan. And that's how we start. So he agreed to make for us, they can make a curve. And I measure our babies, the nose, and come up with these six sizes from size 0 to size 5. Okay? And this, I say that when Mr. Hudson sent a manager to Colombia to look how the CPAP works, and this guy later he became a president, he developed this Bobby Plus CPAP exhibit outside here. So he's the one, so he knows how the CPAP plan should be made. So, but instead of PVC, like a Hudson plan, they use silicone, so more inert to the tissue, okay? And it's a latex free. And he also make a bigger, one bigger size bigger and one small size smallest, okay? Size 0. Then, but this is make of silicone. So the when you have a small one, you have to be very careful because the silicone is not as rigid as the PVC. So you have to make sure they don't pinch, pinch the plant. Okay. Other than that, I think this is very good. And because the bigger size, sometimes you have the BPD outgrow cheaper plant, you can use the bigger plant. So just a lot of people use nasal cannula. So I will spend a couple of minutes talking about nasal cannula. So a lot of people think the nasal cannula is same as the CPAP. No, it's not the same. Okay, nasal cannula, you continuous flow the gas toward the baby continuously. When the baby inspiration, when the baby expiration, he also continue breathe to the gas. The baby's peak inspiratory flow is 3.5 liters, and we put 7 liters. You know, it's a so high flow toward the baby's nose. So how much pressure depends on how much flow you use. how much space they can escape, because when they escape, how to escape from the mouth, or the space is there, okay? All right, but CPAP plant, the gas coming from here, there, and you generate some positive pressure in here, maybe get air from here, exhale to this cannula, okay? So your baby doesn't breathe, he got just a CPAP, he didn't get air like this, okay? So they also use, tell people use a hypoglossal cannula, okay? So you, with the flow, by the way, and the pressures develop, okay? So they come up medium pressures like this. The baby doesn't know the medium pressure is what? This baby, he got a CPAP pressure this much, this baby got that much, okay? And that's depending on pulmonary size, the space, how the baby mouth is open or closed, okay? So, and this is the same like this, okay? But people that tell you the mean pressure is this, okay? I don't know why the people just accept that, all right? So this is a paper actually show in PAS 2009, now it's a paper, come out now. So for instance, he used 1 liter, 100% oxygen, so they need the 69%, but some patients get 49%, some patients get 90%, some patients get CPAP pressure 1.3, some patients get a 19 CPAP pressures. Is that possible? Yes, you can connect to Whitney PSI, and OE can decrease some pressure, but pressure is still so high, okay? So you can easily generate that much pressure if you don't have much space to exhale. Okay, and this also published. So use a hypoglossal cannula. There's a subcutaneous scalp emphysema. Also pneumo-orbitus, also pneumocephalus. Use a hypoglossal cannula on the baby, okay? So you use a so high flow toward the baby. And this study compared hypoglossal cannula with the CPAP. So when they have higher risk, when they have hypoglossal cannula is a higher risk of death or BPE, increased respiratory mobility, delay oral feeding, okay? And also prolonged hospitalization. This is a supply. Everybody thinks, oh, nasal cannula is so simple, so it should be easy to get the oral feedings. But remember, when you are eating, do you breathe when you swallow? You don't, right? If you when you swallow the food or drink and you try to breathe, you will get air, you will get into the trachea. But on the nasal cannula, when the baby suck, but it continue flow toward the baby. I think that's why, probably that's why they have a delayed oral feeding. Okay, so this paper say don't use hypoglossal cannula to replace the CPAP. But the problem is this, see this paper published in JP, this paper published in New England Journal of Medicine. So use hypoglossal cannula and CPAP, so the BPD incident of hypoglossal cannula 36%, so it's 43% on CPAP. This on hypoglossal cannula BPD 31%, on CPAP 34%, okay? Our baby from under 1250, 500 to 125, the BPD incidence is at 36, we still require oxygen, okay? So our, this group patient is 5.9%. 5.9%, not 34%. I don't know how they make how they use a CPAP, okay? But the paper published like that, people, oh, look at it, it's the same. And nasal cannula, of course, is easier. I think nasal plant CPAP is easy, but that's, of course, more easy, okay? But because it's a paper still, so now there's many, many study compared with hypoglossal cannula CPAP. I didn't see one. Nasal cannula is better than CPAP plant, okay? All right, so now they talk about CPAP we use. So at Columbia, so you have an oxygen blender, horometer, this, okay, let's see. Why we don't use the endotracheal tube, why we use the nasal plung, because the resistance for the baby to breathe through the lumen is the length, proportion to length, endotracheal tube is longer, inverse proportion horsepower radius, CPAP plung is 2 plung, endotracheal tube is 1 plung, okay? So resistance much lower. So they compare with the Hudson plung CPAP size 0 for the baby under 700 gram, see that's a resistance. If you intubate that baby with a 2.5, and that will be the resistance with endotracheal tube. That's why they just under, like in UC San Francisco where the Gregory, I remember they say a baby under 1250 gram CPAP doesn't work, because they use endotracheal tube. Okay, we CPAP plan, we have baby 375 gram on CPAP. Okay, all right, so there's a setup. So you have the oxygen blender, horometer, the heated humidifier, because the gas come out here is 0% humidity and it's cold. So you have a heated humidifier. You measure the temperature, inspire temperature, and then you say, inspiratory tubing, so usually it's a corrugating tube, the flexible, okay, that's what you use, and if you can have a heating oil, even better, okay, and you have a nasal cannula, and you have a Velcro, we'll talk about that later, to prevent cannula, don't touch the septum, okay, so then you have if you use this type, you don't have to monitor the pressure, but you use a respirator, then you have to measure the pressures, okay? And expiratory tubing, and just immerse in the liquid. And we use acetic acid solution, because in our unit, to get acetic acid solution is as easy as to get sterile water. So we use acetic acid solution so Pseudomonas won't grow into butter if you forgot to change the butter, okay? But just nothing wrong with sterile water. In the developing country, I told them, you just boil the water and let the water cool down and use that water. Okay, so you can use that. And usually we put the water up to 7 cm, but immerse to 5 cm to get a 5 centimeter water pressures. Okay, all right? So the baby's born, you want to put a CPAP, you position baby head high. Okay, you put a small roll, because the occipital is relatively big, so they may occlude the airway when the neck flexes. So you put a neck, small neck roll, and next, so the head will be extended, so it won't occlude the airway. And you put a hat, and you use that hat to fix the tubing. Premature baby, they lose a lot of heat. There's a lot of blood supply in the scalp, so you lose a lot of heat. So on CPAP or not, they should wear the hat. So you just raise his head to hold the tubing. Okay, you choose the FiO2, now we have auto saturation in 90 to 95, okay? Use that just alarm, okay? For a long time until Smith's study showed this low flow, low oxygen, high flow oxygen, so people use this. For a long time, as long as they are more than 80%, they have enough, okay? So adjust the flow so you will see the air bubble. Why you need 5 to 10 liters? Because it still has some leakage, okay? But you want to use flow so you see the air bubble. You don't want to use more than 10 because the tubing we use is small. So if you use a very high flow, so become significant resistance for some high flow, so the pressure is not maybe a little bit different, okay? So if you require so high flow, so much leakage, I will show you how to seal the leakage, okay? But usually that's unusual, very unusual, require more, that much flow, okay? And just a temperature, usually now 37 degrees. If you had one which is Parker, you can adjust the temperature. If you're a bigger baby, you can be cooler. Very premature baby, you can have a higher. But now we use this fix 37 degree. Okay, so it merges in this, put a 7 centimeter, we put a tape measure there, 7, you put it at 5, you see air bubble, you will see the CPAP pressures, okay? Or you can use a Barbie plus, so outside when you put the dial to 5, that means just tube immersion in the liquid 5 cm, so you see the bubble, you see 5 centimeter water pressure, or use a Fisher Paco, you put just 5, and just immerse 5 cm below the water, okay? And you can do that, or you can put this, had an oxygen blender, and you can just transport the baby inside the hospital. When you go to the x-ray, or you do something, or from the delivery room, go to your NICU, so you can transport the baby easily. So you choose a proper size plan, okay? The sizes smaller is for the small baby, the plan closer together and lumen are smaller, okay? So, or in the size one, or maybe 1,000 gram, their tidal volume is 6 cc. If 3 kilogram, you don't want, that tidal volume is 18 cc, you don't want the plan size one, okay? So you want to see the proper size. And if you had a problem, put a proper size in. That's because the plan is too dry. So you can lubricate the plan with saline, water, or even patient's saliva, okay? And do it, and then you should be able to put it. If you still have a problem, put it, you put one side in, take it out, put the other side, so now take out the, now both sides you dilate it, you should be able to put a proper size plan in, okay? Don't put a, oh, you had a hard time, put it and put a smaller sizes, okay? All right, so we fix the tubing. So before Hudson make a hole us, we don't have a rubber, we don't have a Velcro, so we fix it with a rubber band and safety pin. Okay, all right. So a lot of people say, oh, you have safety pin. You know, they don't call safety pin safe. You know, their reason because they are safe. That's why you call safety pin. Okay, all right. So you said that's who fix it. Okay, and easy to readjust if you're wrong. Or use a Velcro, like you have a Hudson, they give you a Velcro. The problem with some of the Velcro doesn't stick to the heart. But when the developing country, they don't have a safety pin. So they saw this in the heart. So we stay, okay? Or if, so you use a head, but sometimes, like this BPD patient, you outgrow, you don't have the size of the head, so you can use a cream like this, okay? Or like that. But don't put this way for the very tiny baby, otherwise the head will grow like a mango, okay? You put that one, they will grow like this, okay? So this only for the big baby, okay? When you don't have a proper size of the head, okay? All right, or you can use this. You can do any way you want. So you want to make sure this tubing don't move, and make sure you can, this cannula, stay away from the septum. You can do whatever you want, but just make sure this don't touch the septum. You don't touch the septum, no pressure on septum, you don't have problem with septum injury, okay? And you have a quick this so they don't move, and then pull in here. Okay, you can any way you want. Okay, so before I said Fisher Paco on the infant floor, you have a hard time to keep this away from the septum. Okay, and if you don't, cannot keep away from the septum, you cannot put it in the very tiny baby, 500 gram, 600 gram. Otherwise, you're going to get the septum necrosis. So if meconium aspiration syndrome, that's big, that's probable, it's okay. That's it, you touch the septum, that's probably nothing going to happen. So you they give a Velcro to the heart, so you, if you had a problem to keep this away from the septum, then you use a Velcro. The Velcro has two sides. One side is like a hook, other side is a loop. So loop side is smooth, hook side is rough. So you make this like a mustache, and you hook this like this, and hook this so this don't touch the septum, okay? So also this is very sharp, so make sure this don't touch the septum, this mustache. Okay? If you keep it like this, you will see this. Okay? All right? So if you can stay away from that, that won't happen. Okay? How about this to protect a septum? Okay? Why not? Because the pressure behind that strip is a force you touch this divided by surface area. The small strip surface area is very small, so the force doesn't have to be big, you have high pressures. Just like when I use a knife to cut an object, why we don't need much force, we can cut it? Because it's very sharp, very small surface area. That's why you can, because you can generate a lot of pressures. So you don't want to, so you don't want to use this piece to protect septum, okay? All right, so this is a big baby. This is by one of the agency nurse. You know, sometimes you have more patient, you don't have enough nurse, you call the agency nurse, she didn't have experience with the CPAP, so what's a big deal to protect septum? So she put this piece. Okay, next day I found out who did this. She gone already. Okay, so this, look at that, this small baby. This is a big baby. All right, so if you had a patient, okay, so you put a CPAP, you fix it, this away from the septum with a varicose, but just keep pulling toward this nose because it's the outside. There's an EKG wire, there's IV fluid there, there's everything on top of this, and just keep pulling this. Okay, in that case, you use this incubator, tighten the pore hole. So everything on there, tubing, they don't affect here. Okay, or you use this incubator and it just happen, so outside you put a tape on, okay? So everything on top of here, don't pull in the plug on the baby's nose, okay? So you put this baby on CPAP, watch the vital sign, oxygenation activity, okay? This activity is most important monitor, okay? If this baby in the morning, she is very active, in the afternoon he doesn't know. He doesn't move anything. He deposits this baby sick. He got an infection. He maybe had gray hole IVH. Okay? You check the CPAP, inspire, make sure you inspire temperature. You this bubble out of the this bubble. And if there's a condensation water, you in the circuit, you drain. Okay? So, but this is not a really problem, especially use a heating wire. A little bit of water there because they are corrugating, so the fluid doesn't flow so easily. Okay, so you don't get to the, and even on CPAP, you water get into the baby, so baby got to drink water. Okay, so nothing will happen. Okay, but if you are endotracheal tube, this water get into the trachea. You know when you, sometimes when you drink, and you have a drop of water went to trachea, you cough a lot, right? Okay? So you also they make sure the CPAP plug away from septum at all time. If you had a problem to do that, then you use a varicose to keep it. So make sure this don't touch the septum. Okay? So you have a foreign body in the nose, you irritate, you have more, create more secretion. So from time to time, you should take a plug out, suction the nose. And when you have a catheter, you may suction the mouth, suction the pharynx, or suction the stomach, okay? Your baby doesn't swallow too much air, all right? But if baby swallow a lot of air to the stomach, then you have to suction more often, okay? CPAP pressure will use a 5. Intragastric pressure is more than 10. The CPAP pressure don't just push the air into the stomach. The baby has to swallow, okay? So sick baby, no appetite, they don't swallow the air, you don't have much problem, but if he's bigger, he's active, you don't freeze him enough, there was, could be swallow a lot of air, okay? So you have to, if it doesn't happen, you cannot suction so often, so you put an OG tube. Don't put an NG tube in tiny baby, otherwise you occur 50% of the airway, okay? Change that baby's position, any baby on respiratory problem, don't let them stay on one position all the time. And usually we change the CPAP circuit once a week. Okay, so usually we use CPUF5 and we only win oxygen. We don't win the CPUF pressures. So I use a 5. So I'm sure many of you only 5. Okay, why you don't use 8? Remember, the baby is not intubated. So you, me, we had a physiology PIP3 because our darling are smaller. So we have a 3. If you don't believe me, I will stick a needle behind your cricoid and measure the pressure to show you. Okay? So the patient not intubated, so you use a 5. If you intubate that baby, you need to use a PIP8. Okay? All right, that's why and most of the patients use baby, sick baby, the FRC probably lower, they may need more, but those baby probably you already intubate, give them a surfactant already. Okay, so usually the baby on CPAP is not that sick. Why I think is most of the baby is enough. And you know, Dr. Morley's study use 8. They have a pneumothorax like a 9.7%. Nobody uses CPAP had so high incidence of BPD or the pneumothorax. Okay, so we just use a 5, and we accept the FiO2 up to 60% as a failure. Okay, so we only win, and we if a baby on room air CPAP and he's 5, and we think he's ready, we just take it off. And you may think, oh, you're not like this, you take it off like that. No, no such thing. So if you don't believe me, go to the operating room or thoracic surgeon, open the chest, you don't see the lung like this. Okay, surgeon want to get to the field, they have to press the heart, push the air out. Okay, so when you take it out, if you take it out too early, so FRC gradually decrease, now become too small, then he's symptomatic. Okay, so he's not ready, you put it back. Okay, but you don't believe this, when you put a CPAP out, an FRC will be like this. No. Okay. All right, so this study shows three ways to win the CPAP. So the author mentioned in this paper, say, they learned the first one, the first way from Colombia. Okay, so we patient on low-mail CPAP, he was more comfortable, you think he's ready. So you take it off. If he's not symptomatic, don't go oxygen, he's cured. If you symptomatic again, 30 minutes later, 1 hour later, he lose that, we put the CPAP back. Okay? So if you you fail, 30 minutes, you have to put it back tomorrow, don't try again. But if you off the CPAP 3-4 days, and then now you're tachypnea, you want to help him, you put the CPAP back, and next day you can try off. The other way is to try off and on, off and on. Eventually, off time go longer and longer. The third way is when you are off, you give 2 liters of nasal cannula oxygen. Compare these three ways. See then, number one, see the time winning are faster, total day on CPAP are shorter. Okay, the oxygen dilation, the BPD, or the best way is the first one. Okay, that's what we win, okay? So this, I think Dr. Haney involved in this study, you know, this group, they know how to use the CPAP properly. Okay, so when the baby down to 30%, so they divide half continuous CPAP, another half go to nasal cannula. Okay, so the continuous CPAP group, duration required oxygen therapy are shorter, required respiratory support are shorter. Okay. So if you you know, if you know how to use CPAP, you comfortable with the CPAP, don't win the patient to nasal cannula. Okay, you wait until they don't need it. Okay. Besides, you use a Fisher pack or nasal, just like a nasal cannula. That thing is costs $75. Okay. All right, so this continue on room air, not symptomatic, then you win. You are symptomatic again, you put it back, okay? All right, complication. Of course, you deal with just pretty much your baby. You have a complication. So you can have a nasal obstruction from secretion. So if the baby on CPAP is fine, now for some reason he's agitated, you couldn't find the reason, most likely maybe he had a secretion in the nose, you take it out, you suck in the nose, okay? So you lose that, so this won't happen. Okay, gastric distension because the baby swallows air. So the baby abdominal distension, he has to swallow air to stomach and her stomach go to intestine. If you don't get it out when you go to the stomach, and that's going to happen. Especially if you use a caffeine. The caffeine reducts the gastroesophageal junction, also suppress the GI circulation. Okay, so peristalsis are suppressed. So your baby swallows air to the stomach and you don't get it out, go to the intestine, you're going to stay there. And you will become very distended and you may end up having to intubate the patient because of that. Remember the air had to be go to the stomach first, okay? So you go to the stomach, you get it out, then you don't have air go to the intestine. You don't have an abdominal distension problem. Septum necrosis, so make sure candida don't touch the septum. Fracture FiO2, your baby cry, he mix with air, FiO2 decrease, O2 drop. Never see a patient drop and still cry and drop to less. No, well, because I just stop crying, the O2 will come back, okay? Pneumothorax, I don't know how much, but it's real, okay? So usually, one thing is, when they develop pneumothorax, usually it's the first few days. See, I showed you before, we almost 30,000 babies have been treated with the CPAP. If a baby after 1 week never see a patient develop pneumothorax because of CPAP, never see one. Okay, if usually happens, that usually in the first few days. Okay, and also, if baby develop pneumothorax on CPAP is much benign than the patient develop CPAP and on pneumothorax on respirator. So baby on CPAP, if a small pneumothorax, he's not very symptomatic, we even don't bother put a test tube, okay? But he's symptomatic, of course, he has small pneumothorax, we still put on CPAP. I just tell the next shift people, if this baby has a pneumothorax and we conservative treatment, so I watch if he gets worse so they know what happened, maybe pneumothorax getting bigger, they may have to put a test tube, okay? Most complications are preventable, okay? Most could be device wrong, could be the people's experience. Okay, so this baby on CPAP, okay? This is a picture, but trust me, this candida don't touch the septum, okay? So you had a problem with temperature, you can put a saline drop, transparent, so it's still important to see how the baby breathes, okay? So your baby swallow a lot of air, so you put an OG tube. Don't put an NG tube in the tiny baby. BPD, yes, they are big, they're strong, you put an oral, they just keep gagging. You can put a nasal tube, their nose is big, it's okay. But pretty much your baby, you don't do that. You put an oral, if you have a problem, curve in the mouth, you come out one side, tape, and make a, bring the other side, put another tape, so they don't curve in the mouth. And you leave this open if they are not feeding, okay? So, but, so if the air will bend out, but when the gastric juice come out, they occlude the airway, or occlude the lumen. So you, from time to time, you still have to aspirate to make sure the tube is a patent, okay? All right, so your baby, when the sleep muscle relax, the mouth will open, you have too much leakage, then you put a chin strap. When they cry, they still can open their mouth, okay? And when you do that, you have to put an OG tube. Okay, you can put it here for the IV here, or put a temporal arterial line. Yeah, okay, so you can inspect and make sure you don't, you can see the area where the tip of the, over the tip of the catheter. Okay, so when it infiltrates, you know, right away. You can put on palm position, so you must make sure this neck row is bigger, so this don't push this and push in the septum. Okay. So you can have a continual feeding. So your baby also swallow out air. From time to time, you disconnect, aspirate, discard the air, put the milk back, okay? So you still have to make sure this stomach is empty. All right, you can plant position, you can have a photo therapy, you can have a patch file, you can have a patch file. He can, more than 30 to 34 weeks, he can suck, he can have bottle feeding, he can have a breastfeeding, okay? So I don't know why a lot of people think baby on CPAP is a contraindication to feed them. This study show, no, they have adequate aerial digestive reflex to prevent aspiration. So we have been feeding baby on CPAP for decades, okay? So this 395 gram baby on CPAP since birth. Of course, he doesn't need intubation. He doesn't need suvoctin. He doesn't need LMA or suvoctin. Okay? All right? So this baby never gets suvoctin, never intubate. Okay? Even don't have PDA, no complication. This baby went home a week before the due date. Okay, so your baby just on CPAP, the complication is much lower. Okay, so this kind of CPAP setup, you can do the NIPPV as well. Okay, so your patient are still frequent apnea. You want to try the caffeine, fine, it will work, great. Doesn't work, you go to plan B and will be NIPPV. And when you go to NIPPV, you stop the caffeine. Because you're going to push more air to the stomach, you risk abdominal distension. And since the caffeine doesn't work, so why you keep it? Okay? Or the baby CO2 is high, you want to help, you can do this NIPPV. Okay, now most of the respirator intubate, you can use SIM, we can use the AC, but when you don't intubate, that doesn't work. The only thing work is a servo eye, you use a NAMA. If you have to synchronize. But most of the patients, NIPPV, you don't need to be using NAMA. We still use a regular NIPPV. And if you have some problem, you think NAMA will help, that's the only time we use a NAMA. So you may have to seal. If too much leakage, you seal, you put a chin strap, you have to OG tube. Okay? So the lot of people, NIPPV didn't work. Okay? So this is what we said. That's what we said. What the baby gets pressure is here, in this Draeger, she's there. She's like 10, okay? So that pressure is so much leakage, no wonder it doesn't work, okay? So don't just set the respiratory setting. You have to know how much pressure the patient get, okay? So the only thing synchronized is the servo, the I, servo N, okay? So you can detect with EMG from a diaphragm or EDI catheter and trigger the respirator and its pressures and its volume, its flow. Okay, this is the only one I know can be synchronized. Okay, and you too much leakage from the nose, you use a thin duodenum, the one surgeon hold the colostomy, the thinner one, and you cut this and make a hole, use a puncture. Make a hole and ship a plant go through that hole and seal the nose. Okay, or like this. Or you can buy the cannulate, okay, to seal the nose. So your problem with the pressures. So you see, it's just leaking from the nose or from the mouth. So you pinch the nose, then you have a pressure, so it's from the nose. You close the mouth. You see the pressure increase, so you know it's from the mouth. So you put a chin strap, okay? So when we think CPAP failure, is baby still had a severe retraction. I mean severe retraction, not just some mild retraction. The most severe retraction is a sternum kissing the vertebra. That's the most severe one, okay? So if that's kind of patient, doesn't matter he's on room air or what, if he do like that, he want to exhaust it, those patients will be intubated, you know, holding along with the CPAP. Frequent apnea bradycardia, you can try on the CPAP, but if a failure, doesn't work. Okay, FiO2, more than 60%. Remember, the surfactant only available, FDA approved 1990. 1987, we did a study, surfactant, no surfactant, there's no difference in our unit. Okay, we already cured 1,000 of the baby before Sawatan invented. Okay, so now the baby is okay. So we know, I think the baby on CPAP, if 80%, he still have a good chance to recover. So we just, when our new people come in, they all used to prophylactic Sawatan, so I compromise. So 60%, okay? If less than 60%, he doesn't need intubation, okay? It's a CPAP. Or your CO2 is very high, okay? Thus, you consider our CPAP failure. So this 500 to 1500 gram in 1997 to 99, 320 patients, okay? 230 patients just near CPAP in the first 24 hours. Usually, your CPAP failure is within 24 hours, usually, if not enough, okay? And if I have 60 patient try CPAP first, and if a failure, like require FiO2 more than 60%, then we intubate. And if he, because RDS, we give a surfactant, or if he's not breathing because of magnesium sulfate, of course, you intubate, you ventilate, FiO2 can be dropped very quickly. Those patients, you don't get surfactant either, okay? Some of the patients don't, after resuscitation, he doesn't breathe, okay? Then the intubate is only 30% of that, 30% of that. Okay, you look at this, 500 grams to 700 grams. Once the two-thirds, you try CPAP first, but one-third of this is on CPAP only. One-third try CPAP, but later had to be intubated, okay? And one-third had to be intubated right from the beginning, even under 750. Your baby is over 1,000 gram, see the 85.5% of patients just near CPAP. And you remember the insecure, what size is the baby? Their baby is over 1,000 gram. So I like the insecure idea to quickly extubate the patient, your patient intubate, but we don't routinely do that. Otherwise, it will be 85.5% of the baby was intubated, give a surfactant unnecessary, okay? So you see that even 1,000 gram of babies, even the 500 gram to 750, one-third just near CPAP. So the baby, when the bone, if we require resuscitation, we resuscitate after decide how to breathe, he's breathing, we try CPAP first, okay? If a baby just near CPAP, see the BPD? Very low, okay? So how about grade 3, grade 4 IVS severe? Very low too, okay? ROP, I think the disease of very premature baby. So maybe you have nothing to do with CPAP or respirator. Mortality, of course, if on CPAP only, very, very low incidence, okay? So we think they, we early nasal CPAP therapy first, if they're breathing, even after resuscitation. And if it's not enough, then CPAP failure, then we give a surfactant, still not too late, as a rescue, okay? Still not too late. And this is a study do exactly the same way, okay? And see the group try on CPAP first, okay? And this right from beginning prophylactic surfactants. See the BPD is no different, but this group, 50% of the patient doesn't need surfactants. Okay, so this compared with Columbia, with Vermont, Oxford. Vermont, Oxford, you know, there's in the United States almost 1,000 unit center joined this. So the incidence of BPD. Our is 7.7%. Oxford, Vermont, 34.6%. Nosocomial infection, we are not higher. It is an all grade IVH, okay? With the lower incidence ROP, about the same. NEC, not higher. Mortality is lower, okay? And just compare with just 4 units or 10 years. There's a 4 unit. The one, this one, Okay, the blue one, that's a 4-unit. The OG neonatology are trained at Columbia, so they're able to practice the way they learn at Columbia. Okay, so just 4-unit combined, compared with the Oxford Vermont. Okay, these are the BPD Oxford Vermont network, and that's a 4 centers. For 10 years, the same home with the oxygen, the same home with the oxygen is here, and that's Oxford Vermont. I don't remember when last time we have premature baby had to send home with the oxygen. I don't remember how long ago, okay? All right, don't blame a hormone therapy as useless. In reality, it was only inappropriately applied. Like this patient, transferred to us because of NEC, okay? So the septum is gone. So I asked the father, what kind of CPAP plan they use? He doesn't know. But he had a picture, so bring me the picture. So he sees the picture, how they try to protect the septum. Just peace, right? And that's why they use the Hudson CPAP plan. Okay, this unit probably, oh, Hudson CPAP plan, no good, cause septum necrosis, you know, probably they got. Okay, yeah, you know what, they just didn't do it right. Okay, this baby is waiting for heart transplant. Very complicated disease. Even our cardiologist doesn't know exactly what his anatomy. So they wait, but he had a congestive heart failure, so he's on CPAP. He waited, the community had raised the money for him to get the cardiac transplant. He waited, he couldn't wait, he didn't wait the donut. But he doesn't need it, he grew out of it. Okay, he was on CPAP for a long time. The father is a photographer. He took just a picture, and he gave me just a picture. Okay, thank you. This 480 gram, okay? So this is our transitional nursery. So we know this baby is coming, okay? So we prepare. But sometimes we have a patient, the delivery, the bed, we bring it here, So this baby kinky moving like that, he can do that, he can breathe. So give him a chance. You see, this our fellow, so his hand is so big. And this baby kinky moving, that he listens to the heartbeat. That's unnecessary, right? So he's a crew. Occlude the view, later you see I push his hand away. Okay, see, I'm not just talking, I walk too, you know. Okay, I think I push his hand away now. Come on. Okay, all right, so you quickly dry the baby and you put a CPAP plan on, all right? So now you're going to put a head so this may come out, right? So you just ask anybody, assistant, that is a resident, went to the delivery room, bring me to the baby here. So I ask him to hold the plan. All you need is 3 fingers, okay? Thumb and the index, middle finger on the chin, and just on the plan, baby move, just stay with the plan. So you can fix the, you can fix the head. Okay, she's just a resident, 3 fingers, right? So you have an extra hand, you can put a EKG, you can put an ultrasound in the right hand. On that one, oh, that's one, the pressure, if you use design, if you use a respirator, measure the pressures. So the baby, you know, doesn't matter how small, you they give them a chance, okay? And you find you're surprised, many of them can be just near CPAP. So his O2 sat 95, so you can decrease FiO2 respiration rate and just EK heart rate. Okay. So after you do all this, then the next thing we'll put a, this size baby, we'll probably put a UAC. Okay, USC is in. Okay, so that's a blood pressure. If this doesn't impress you, let's see the next one.
Dr. Ron?
Yeah.
May I ask a question?
Well, it doesn't work in there.
This one?
Yeah, it's got the next one, yeah.
20 is your brain?
Okay, so this baby precipitate delivery in bed. So the obstetrician dropped this to us. His APGAR score is 1. Okay, so he near resuscitate. And when you resuscitate, don't just put a mask and ambu. You have to make sure the chest excursion. She doesn't respond. I'm the one taking the video. See, so I took over. Okay, couple pup baby moving, kicking like that, so he can be on CPAP. So the baby, even after resuscitation, then you watch and see how they breathe, you can put on a CPAP. And that's in premature babies often. If obstetrician take a little bit longer to deliver the baby, they're almost all near resuscitation. So you resuscitate, and when they recover, they can move like that. It's okay. So, you know, 700 gram is not small for us. So I think the nurse will take a little bit longer time to suction, okay? And now the baby become depressed again. So at this point, you can just stimulate the baby, or you pick up and move back, get him back again, and then put a CPAP. Okay. Okay. So this device is magnified. So it looks like we stimulate, but we are not really just rough. So that's not a gasping, he's crying. The baby's still crying.
Can you just close the door if you don't mind? I don't know. And I don't feel like enjoying the spectators. No, I know, but I'm just not evil from that.
So the fellow is discussing what's the APGAR score they want to put. So the auto start, so you can decrease, so 50% you can decrease the FiO2, the auto start is high. Okay, both this baby doesn't need no intubation. They're only on CPAP. So he's here crying, okay? Okay. Well, thank you.